And you. Okay, well, thanks everybody for being on. Chodesh Tov, Shana Tova, Happy New Year for the animals. And we're doing something very bold, very audacious, hopefully very historic. We're trying to restore the ancient New Year for animals, which occurred on this date, Rosh Chodesh Elul. We're trying to restore it. Initially, it was tithing for sacrifices. We're certainly not trying to bring that back. But we want to transform this ancient Jewish holiday into a day devoted to increasing awareness of Jewish teachings on compassion for animals and how far the realities for animals are from these teachings. And of course, there's a precedent for that in terms of Tu B'Shvat.
Are we all still supposed to be muted?
Yeah, I guess.
I wanted to say hello and Chodesh Tov to everybody. Okay, Shalom Aleichem.
Shalom. Okay, so we're trying to restore this ancient holiday. I want to just give a little background about myself. Richard Schwartz, I'm President Emeritus of Jewish Veg, former Jewish Vegetarians in North America, author of a few books, including this one here, third edition, Judaism and Vegetarianism. And most recently, Vegan Revolution, Saving a World, and Revitalizing Judaism. Some strong ambitions to save the world, revitalize Judaism, minor details. Hopefully we can do that. So the thing is, I like to quote Victor Hugo. He said, "Nothing is as powerful as an idea whose time has come." And I believe the idea of restoring this ancient holiday, time has come. The time has come to really get veganism on the Jewish agenda. And the time has come to really do everything possible to shift our planet onto a sustainable path. Now, I want to give a few reasons why I think the time has come. One is that our arguments are becoming stronger and stronger, can't be really critical. We are saying that animal-based diets and agriculture violate basic Jewish teachings, including taking care of our health, treating animals with compassion, protecting the environment, conserving natural resources, helping hungry people, and seeking and pursuing peace. And here's an amazing, amazing thing. The current issue, if you see this, of Jerusalem Report has my cover story. And I don't know if you can read the words there, but basically it says, little old me, Richard H. Schwartz, argues that eating animal products violates Jewish teachings. So that's been out for a while. No rabbi has written a letter or really contradicted that. So this is a strong case. I think it's so strong that people can't really overcome it. Another reason I think our time has come, here in Israel, some consider a vegan capital of the world, and also throughout the world, there are so many plant-based substitutes for meat and other animal products, so that really the excuse that some people have about the taste, that should be gone. And perhaps the main reason time has come is that it's essential, many things have to be done to avert a climate catastrophe, but one for sure is there has to be a reduction in consumption of animals. There has to be really a major shift toward veganism. And for the reason I say that, some studies have indicated that because of methane emitted by cows, animal-based agriculture is one of the prime factors in causing climate change. One UN Food and Agricultural Organization even said that it's more important in causing climate change than all the cars, planes, ships, all the means of transportation in the world combined. So we need that shift. And I don't know if you noticed, it's very timely. Just today, every 7 years, they come out, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change produced its latest report, and it's more frightening than ever. Code red, it is called, and indicating that we're in, unfortunately, for some very severe climate events. And of course, we're seeing that every day, the floods in Germany, other parts of Europe, in China, in India, and in addition, the wildfires, now it's increased, before that in California. Governor of Oregon said, the West is burning, we'll do everything possible to avert a climate catastrophe. Many more facts should be brought out, but I want to get to the wonderful speakers we have. So once again, the objective to restore, transform this ancient New Year holiday, get the animal issue onto the agenda, get people to recognize that shift to veganism is essential to avert climate catastrophe. Many other things also have to be done. So I want to introduce our first speaker, and that is Rabbi Arthur Waskow. And we're both 87. We've been both working on this for quite a while. I've been very inspired by many of Arthur's books. And he started this wonderful group, the Shalom Center, that has been excellent in, with regard to peace, environmental, social justice issues. And he's like a modern day prophet. So Arthur, I'd like to hear what you have to say with regard to this issue.
Shalom, everybody, and Kodesh Tov. And I want to thank Richard Schwartz for bringing us together to do this. He is the most indefatigable and indomitable proponent of Jewish vegetarianism and veganism that I think has probably ever, for sure, since the early biblical days, existed in the Jewish world. And I'm glad to have today as a marker of his persistence. So there are two lessons from the story I'm about to tell you. The first lesson arises from what you need to know, that as the coronavirus lockdown first took effect about a year and a half ago, my 19-year-old grandson, Elior Waskow, emailed me, "Granddad, you clearly know a lot of Torah. How about we make a chevrusa, a partnership, to study Torah once a week?" So I was totally pleased by the invitation. And we decided to alternate which one of us would choose a passage to read from the Torah portion or from the accompanying Haftarah. When we got to Parshat Shmini, I chose the Haftarah, which is from 2 Samuel chapter 6. It's the story of what happened when King David tried to bring the Ark of the Covenant to his capital city, Jerusalem, hoping to add to his prestige as a kind of upstart king. The ark was carried in a cart drawn by a team of oxen. The oxen stumbled, according to most translations. Everett Fox says they let it slip. One of the guards grabbed the ark to keep it from falling to the ground, and he was instantly struck dead. Everybody thinks this incident is to point out, like the tale of Aaron's sons, point out the inexplicably awesome tremendum of God's presence. So the touching of the ark, like bringing strange fire, brought death. But Elior, who was closely reading the Hebrew, interrupted. "Granddad, here's your favorite word in the whole Tanakh." "What?" said I. "Shemitah," he said, "your favorite word, release, the seventh year, when earth is released from overwork and human beings are released from debt. See," he said, "right here, Shamtu Habakar, the oxen made a release." "Wait a minute," I said. "The oxen didn't stumble. The burden of pulling the ark was too great. The burden of adding to the king's prestige for his own sake, not for God's sake, that burden was too great. They tried to release themselves from the burden, and the guard tried to force them to bear the burden. For this, the breath of life, yeah, stopped breathing. For this, God's nose was inflamed with anger, says the text. For this was the guard struck dead. For the freedom of the oxen from overwork was more important than housing the ark in a fragrant cedar box in a palace to make the king even more powerful. That discovery transforms the meaning of the passage. And I am tickled pink, as my mother used to say, that it was Eleor who discovered it and knew that Shemitah was one of my favorite parts of Torah. One of those moments when a whole life journey feels worthwhile. Lesson one, I said there were two. Lesson one, always learn from the future. Always learn from your grandchildren. Lesson two, animals are entitled to Shemitah, to release from a burden too heavy to bear. Animals, including humans, but not limited to humans. Especially important lesson as we enter a Shemitah year, exactly 1 month, you might say 1 month from now. So I'm glad to do this on the new year for animals in honor of those oxen and their attempt to release themselves from too heavy a burden. I'm glad to share this story in honor of Shemitah for us all. Dibarti.
Okay, Todah Rabah, thank you very much. And moving on, next speaker is Rabbi Ellen Bernstein. She founded Shomrei Adama many, many years ago, the Guardians and Keepers of the Earth. And that was the first international Jewish environmental organization. Remember how much it meant to me when I was sort of getting started many years ago. That was in 1988. She's the author of numerous books, including The Promise of the Land, A Passover Haggadah. And she writes and teaches on Bible and ecology. She's an advisor to the Yale Forum on Religion and Ecology. Okay, so looking forward to hearing from Rabbi Ellen Bernstein. Hope she's here. Now we have to move on.
Ellen is here, Richard.
Muted, maybe.
I was just muted. Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah, yes. We hear you.
Great. Greetings and a huge thank you to the indefatigable Richard Schwartz. I'm going to focus my comments today on the opportunities that Rosh Hashanah Behemot, the new year for the animals, affords to all of us Jews and people around the world. Talking about celebration and holidays may seem like an anathema given the destruction all around us, the breakdown of ecological systems, the loss of habitat and biodiversity, and the tragedy of factory farming. My heart too is broken. How can we talk about celebration in the face of so much suffering? And yet we must. Holidays can help lift our spirits, nurture us on the path of leading more ecologically sound lives, and bond us together on the communal path to just living. I want to suggest a few ideas of ways to celebrate our animal kin to help get us thinking of what might be possible for honoring this holiday. Because there's no specific liturgy, the New Year for the animals can be a catalyst for creativity, a vehicle for reaching across the religious secular divide, and an opportunity to engage young people in new and exciting ways. What child doesn't love animals? The very idea of a New Year for the animals is completely irresistible. One particularly Jewish way to celebrate would be to develop a Seder for the animals New Year, similar to the Seder for the New Year for the trees, Tu B'Shvat. So let me offer a little of my own experience in helping to reinvent Tu B'Shvat. 35 years ago, Shomrei Adama developed an ecologically centered Tu B'Shvat Seder based on the Kabbalistic Seder, and we've been celebrating ever since. In this Seder, the Kabbalistic four worlds translate organically into the elements of earth, water, air, and fire. Artists in our community decorate the space, creating a virtual Garden of Eden. The hundreds of guest participants choose a plant or animal that has particular meaning for them and come to the Seder garbed in their creaturely attire. We read from the Haggadah, bless, eat, and imbibe the fruits and wines for each world, listen to musical offerings, contemplate our place in nature, and discuss the environmental issue of the four worlds. Integrating pageantry, art, and theater, along with religious insights and ecological understandings, we celebrate the New Year of the Trees in a new and meaningful way. I imagine that a similar kind of structure and ritual could help catalyze our thinking about the New Year for the animals. Another way to celebrate, either community-wide or in your own institution or camp, would be to hold an all-species parade. In the all-species event that Shomrei Adamah ran for Earth Day 1990, we work with children in schools all over Philadelphia, educating them in the species and habitats of the world. Children chose a species, learned everything they could about it, and participated in the parade, dressed as their favorite species. Whole classes came as ecosystems. How about an all-species parade as the central focus of camp activity instead of color war? Why are we emphasizing war in play anyway? The New Year of the Animal poses some practical questions since it usually falls in August when many folks are on vacations and rabbis are busy preparing for the high holidays. So even if doing big special events is out of the question, we can still consider how we can bring animal-centered programming into our Jewish institutions during the month of Elul. There are innumerable ways of doing this, from developing curricula and educational materials for Jewish educators, to partnering with local animal-centered institutions, to speaker talks on Friday nights, to participating in bird counts, to advocating for the rights of the health of animals. The conjunction between Rosh Hashanah Behemot, the birthday of the animals, which begins today, and the official Rosh Hashanah, the birthday of the creation of the world, which begins 1 month from now, lends itself to especially meaningful opportunities. The idea that the Jewish New Year, Rosh Hashanah, is the birthday of creation of the whole natural world doesn't get nearly enough attention in most synagogues. By linking the animals' New Year with the central Jewish New Year and identifying Elul as a month of animal-centered programming culminating in Rosh Hashanah would enhance and reinforce the creation theme of Rosh Hashanah. I myself have long thought about creating some kind of musical pageant honoring all the animals of Genesis 1 as a way of celebrating the birthday of the world. There is endless potential. This is just a snippet of possibilities this hidden gem of a holiday promises. I look forward to the blossoming of this holiday in the years to come. Thanks.
Okay, many thanks for these creative ideas, and hoping, you know, this is new, that we'll come up with ideas and how to celebrate this holiday more and more. Okay, next speaker is really a pioneer in moving the New Year for Animals forward. It's Aharon Varady, and he also is a founding director of the Open Siddur Project, and way back, more than 10 years ago, he was involved in this. So look forward to hearing from Aharon Varady. I think he's here, so they have to unmute.
I'm muted. I am now. Thank you. Thanks to everyone working on behalf of alleviating the suffering of non-human animals. And thank you to all the Jewish educators and rabbis studying Rosh Hashanah Labehema and programming activities, prayers, and rituals for this day. It's so crucial, I think, that we, the Jewish community, set aside one day of the year to emphasize decentering our human needs and recentering the needs of those animals that depend upon us and our voices to speak up for their well-being and to do so at the outset of our season of tshuva, the repair of all of our relationships. And thank you to Richard Schwartz for listening to me already 10 years ago when I first wrote to him in August 2011. So it's 10 years today, asking for your help in reviving this New Year's Day. And so we have, this is a 10-year milestone. And I wanna go over some of the accomplishments, the resources that we have, and some of the concerns that I have. Some of you, and I wanna go over the history so people know what the history of this has been. Some of you know me as the founding director of the Open Siddur Project, the open source archive of Jewish prayers. I am a community planner and environmental planner by profession. After founding the Open Siddur Project in 2009, I taught Jewish environmental education with Teva at Isabella Friedman Retreat Center. And it was there in the fall of 2010 that I met Rabbi Jill Hammer. And I also met Rabbi Waskow for the first time. But it was on Rosh Chodesh Elul that year that I found Rabbi Hammer and Kohenet Sarah Chandler organizing a very special activity at the goat barn of the Adama Jewish Farming Fellows. And they were celebrating the lives of the goats with a short and fun ritual for Rosh Hashanah Labehema. And I was overjoyed. I had been wanting to celebrate Rosh Hashanah Labehema since I first learned of it and the mitzvah of Tsar Balei Chaim in the fifth grade. They redeemed Judaism for me as a tradition concerned with the needs of beings who don't look like me, who don't look like anybody who is a human being, who is a person. All these other people, all these other creatures, beings, they were also being celebrated as part of the community. Uvhemtecha, just like we would say in the Kiddush and Shabbos, that these animals, these domesticated animals, are part of our community. And this was doing so much more than just talking the talk. It was actually living it. It was celebrating it. And I was so joyful about that. And I asked to share a short kavana on listening for the voices of the animals in the blast of the shofar. And my heart melted when they said, yes, please join us. And then later in the summer of 2012, at a Chazon-sponsored conference in Tiberias called Siach, I suggested this initiative, and other Jewish animal advocates and welfare organizations, both secular and religious, joined with me in Israel. And we had a meeting about it, and we got together about it. And we had, I think the first meeting was with Shmuel Yankelowitz Shemayim V'aretz. And I got my first email back from Richard saying, hey, we're gonna start doing this. And the ball was rolling. And so here we are. That's the history of this. Our Rosh Hashanah Labehema is still so small, and very few Jews, rabbis, and Jewish educators even know about it. And that's 10 years. But I want to say, like, two of the things I'm most proud about us having achieved is that on hebcal.com, not all of you know about hebcal, it's the Hebrew calendar web application, and it's used by a tremendous number of Jews. Hebcal lists Rosh Hashanah Labehemot in its calendar, and other calendars are created from their calendar. So Rosh Hashanah Labehemot is now on the calendar of many Jews who know nothing about Rosh Hashanah Labehema. But that's okay, because we also have a Wikipedia page for Rosh Hashanah Labehema. It's in English. There's no like Rosh Hashanah Labehema page in Hebrew, and that's still a problem. So that's something we need to rectify. But the one in English talks about our work as Jewish animal advocates and activists and organizers in reclaiming and reviving this day for the entire community and for a tikkun olam. So with my remaining time, I just want to go over what are the other resources available for folks who might not know that, you know, we all love this day and we're invited to this day, but not everybody has seen the source sheet that I made for Rosh Hashanah Labehema. And I'll add a link to that in the chat. Not everybody has seen the Kavanah made for listening to the Shofar Blast or for the special Birkat HaMazon supplement that's been written. There's a whole bunch of works that have been created for this, and they're all online at opensiddur.org, including some amazing, amazing ritual. And it's incredible to hear Ellen Bernstein describe rituals like this in an all species parade and other role-playing like activities. It's something I learned from Rabbi Seidenberg, who will be speaking later, this practice called the Council of All Beings. And it's just such an obvious suggestion for this. And I would love to see if we do start promoting some kinds of Seder. And I hope that that Seder will be a vegan Seder or only include foods that we share with other domesticated animals and focus first on the lives and needs of domesticated animals, that at this Seder, we have some, maybe it's preceded by a council of all beings, and maybe it incorporates a reading of the Perek Shira, where each participant at the Seder takes the voice of a creature, aspect of creation that's blessing Hashem with their particular unique being.
Okay, one more minute.
But more than that, also giving voice in our human voice, but giving voice through their voice, what the actual problems are today for them and their species and their community of beings. And there's more, but I'll add the link to the resources in the chat at opensiddur.org. And I really encourage everyone who hasn't been in touch with me concerning this festival, reviving this festival, please be in close touch with me. I want to collaborate and work with you on this. So please be in touch and thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks for your pioneering efforts, and good to see that it's progressing, and hopefully we'll go from strength to strength. Okay, next speaker is Rabbi Michael Lerner. He's the founding editor of Tikkun magazine. And over the years, I've got great inspiration from his books, especially Jewish Renewal, some of his books on peace and reconciliation between Jews and Palestinians, and articles and his talks. So look forward to hearing Rabbi Michael Lerner.
It's an honor to be with you. I've learned so much from you, Richard Schwartz, and have so deep appreciation for all the work that you've done. It's amazing and centrally important. Also want to acknowledge the an honor to be with Arthur Waskow and Ellen Bernstein and David, and there's so many wonderful people here. I feel like, what am I doing here? I don't deserve to be amongst these greats. But anyway, here I am. So I just, what I have to say is purely preaching to the choir. But here's one thing I can say that is not preaching to the choir. All of your talks, and other people are on this who are not talking but have important things to say, write them up and send it to me, okay? Because I'd love to put it out to the tens of thousands of readers of or recipients of Tikkun, okay? So Rabbi Lerner, L-E-R-N-E-R, rabbilerner.tikkun@gmail.com, because I'd love to be able to spread all of this information today and all of the things that you have to say to a much larger audience. I had a sign in my in my house that said, "If you love animals, don't eat them." It was a way of remembering that, reminding myself and others who came there that animals are conscious beings who suffer pain and joy and their lives and well-being should be important to us. The horrific way animals are bred for human consumption and often tortured and on along the way ought to be illegal. I mean, like a law about it, okay? It, not just a halakhic law, I mean, a public law in our in the society as a whole. And we ought to put that forward as one of our goals. The killing of animals may have had a point at one point in human history when, and may have been necessary for self-preservation when we were prey and they were hunters. That is a long, long past. And I'm not so sure that that wasn't made up actually as an excuse for human beings to be eating animals and not the real history. when we learn as we did a few days ago, the killing of animals is a slippery slope to the killing of human beings also. And its function actually in our society is to harden our hearts to the spread at least for the past few thousand years, it has hardened our hearts to the pain of killing human beings. It's a slippery slope. There's no absolute way to stop from the one to the other, because the place where we should be drawing the line is at least on all sentient animals. Anybody that can feel pain should not be put into pain. And so that's, I think, is extremely important when we look at, learned from a few days ago from Haaretz that IDF soldiers participated last week in, and maybe more frequently than that, just reported last week with West Bank settlers in killing random Palestinians. The immediate association is to the tendency to forget about the Jewish notion of reducing pain, not increasing it. And now, in the last few decades, we've come to understand that a significant percentage of destroying the Earth's support life support system results from the raising of animals to satisfy the tastes of for animal flesh. In the mislabeled advanced societies of North America and Europe. We have so much we must do for tshuva around these issues. And we don't have to just do it on the first of Elul. We should also bring it into one of the topics that we add to the list of Avinu Malkeinu Chatanu, you know, and on Al Chet Sebaba. Add this chait is a very, very important one. We certainly must do tshuva for the pain, the suffering, and the killing of animals. If there's one commandment that must be central to our consciousness is this, do not cause conscious beings to suffer. And for that reason, I think we should be insisting that animal rights should be integral to the current and next stages of Judaism, for a Judaism of love and caring that we would want badly to see, and to any social progressive movement that we're part of, to raise that there as well. That's all I'm going to say.
Okay, beautiful. Thank you very much. Okay, great to have you. Okay, next speaker is Rabbi David Mubarak Seidenberg. A PhD, and he's a creator and director of the website neochassid.org, which teaches eco-Torah, new liturgy, and Hasidic melody. He's also the author of an interesting book, Kabbalah and Ecology, God's Image in a More Than Human World, and he's one of the most creative people in relating Jewish teachings to environmental issues. So look forward to hearing from David.
Thank you so much, Richard. It's so nice to be here. It's such a pleasure to be invited. And thank you to all my colleagues here. It's really an honor to be among you. I just put in the chat two links. One is for a council of all beings, which Aharon Varady mentioned. And the second is the link to the Omer Counter app. And I gave you that second link because the Omer Counter app has a countdown to Rosh Hashanah. This week is all about Rosh Hashanah LeBehema, all the quotes for every day. And I recommend both of them to you. I want to think a little bit beyond what Rosh Hashanah LeBehemot is truly, which is about domesticated animals and how we treat the animals that we are directly responsible for, because we are living in a time, as we know painfully and horrifyingly well today with the IPCC report, in which everything is essentially domesticated by human beings or under our control, under our dominion and domination, and lives or dies at our hands. We are, in fact, for sure, in the middle of the sixth mass extinction in the Earth's history, and we are the cause of it. Rosh Hashanah is coming up, and that reminds us of the creation of the world, and there's a beautiful passage in Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer about the creation of Adam, which talks about what happened in each hour of the creation, and between the fifth and the sixth hours is the story that I'm about to read to you. So in the fifth hour was when the human had been finished being shaped and stood up. And in the sixth hour is when all the animals got their names. So this happens right in between those two moments. According to Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer, Amar Adam, the human stood up, Vayah mistakel kalpei mala v'mata, and looked, peered above and below, u'ra'eh kol habriyot shebara HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and saw all of the creatures that the Holy One had created. Vayah tema bilibo, there was wonder in the human being's heart. The immediate response was, the human began to give praise and give beauty to the one who formed all of this beauty. And he said, or they said, how diverse are your works, Adonai. Rabu. Rabu means not just many, but diverse. It's that diversity that we're killing now. It's that diversity which sustains us and all life in its myriad relationships. The human being got up and all the animals saw the human being, Hayat Bitoar Kidmut Elokim, in the image of God, and as big as the whole skies, because according to the Midrash, the first human was as big as the whole sky. They saw the human, Ureoto, Kola Briot, Unit Yaru. They were afraid, in awe of this one, and they thought, this is the one who created us. So they went to bow down before the human being. What happened next? This is the key. This is what it means to be a human being in our purpose of creation. The human said to them, Lama batem lishtachavot? Why are you coming to bow down to me? Let's all go together, I and all of you, and we will go and we will clothe the Creator in glorious majesty and make the Creator rule over us. Note, the Creator doesn't rule over us except that we make it happen. And we do it in this midrash by joining together with the animals, not by separating ourselves from the animals. So they did. They all went together to praise God, to worship God, to beautify God. And they said together the next verse, in the next psalm, Adonai malach geirut lavish. Adonai ruled because we animals and human, or other animals, as well as the human animal, made the God rule and dwell and be clothed in majesty. If we can live rightly, then we bring all of creation with us and bring us all in relationship to God. And that's what it means to be an animal among the animals and a human animal among the other animals. If not, we wake up with tema, wonder, not wonder, but shock at what we've done to the glorious beauty and diversity of this creation. We have very little time to change what's going to happen. I think you all know that. If we don't change this before the next Shemitah year, to use the silly animal metaphor, our goose is cooked. Not a good metaphor for a vegan crowd, but cooked is a good metaphor for what's happening to the earth. So may we all be strengthened. May we learn in Rosh Hashanah LeBehemot to focus our wisdom and our strength on changing the course of human civilization so that we are not the first and last generation to celebrate Rosh Hashanah, the Behemot. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. And unfortunately, it's all too true what you're saying. We have so little time, and hopefully, during this new year for animals was a great step toward changing things around. Okay, now, special interest for next speaker, that is Lionel Friedberg. He is a multi-award-winning producer, director, writer, cinematographer, and he is the producer of the wonderful video that the Jewish Vegetarians in North America put out some years ago, Sacred Duty, Applying Jewish Vow to Help Heal the World. So important, we gave out like 40,000 of them. And to me, it was great credit. He did this wonderful thing. And by the way, if you haven't seen it, take a look, go to sacredduty.com. Really a great, great documentary. Came out in 2007, but still very relevant. Anyway, we wanted it without one penny of professional fee, and we can never do it without it. His wife also, Diana, as a professional editor, and no professional fee. So really appreciate what he's done. So we look forward to hearing from Lionel Friedberg.
Thank you, Richard. It's a great honor and a pleasure to be with, can you hear me, everybody?
Yeah, we hear you.
You know, Richard, I've so often said that, you know, you really are in every way at Tzaddik. I see you so much in that sense. You have brought light unto the world. And again, thank you for arranging this session. It's long overdue. And if anybody can do it, you do. And once again, you've come to the cause. You are an amazing individual. So I respect you very much for what you do. And as Rabbi David Seidenberg has just said, you know, we humans, we're certainly living in a new age. We're living in the Anthropocene. The era that we live in now is the age of man, and we are the ones who are changing and impacting the world. It's no longer natural systems and the natural course of events that make things happen on the planet. We are now responsible for what goes on. And the report that came out today from the United Nations, oddly enough, just before Rosh Chodesh Elul, which is kind of in its own way, has some meaning to it. You know, we're in a time of great danger, and our planet is at stake, and we are responsible for changing the course of events. And we really have to rally to the cause. It's very, very difficult. I find it very difficult to get through to people, and yet we have to persevere. And being in the company of all of you, you know, gives me hope, because often I feel a great sense of despair. How do we do this? How do we accomplish what we're trying to do? And as Richard has often said, you know, we Jews have to be a light unto the nations, without being arrogant about it, but we've got to bring about something to actually change the course of events. And the time is now. We've got to do it. You know, I live in a city here in Los Angeles. We now have over 200 vegan restaurants, dedicated vegan restaurants in LA, which is amazing. I think it's more than any other city in America. Israel, of course, leads the world in terms of veganism, but LA is up there. And we're certainly setting an example for the rest of the country. But all is not well at all. And COVID has had its impact on the whole situation. I'm not sure if all of you are aware of the fact that in 2020 under Donald Trump, when a lot of the slaughterhouse workers got COVID, a lot of the smaller slaughterhouses closed down. And so there was a shortage of meat. And Donald Trump said, well, in that case, the slaughter industry, you can regulate yourselves now. Do as much as you can to supply the demand. And that was a horrifying beginning for a whole series of new events that now take place in the meat industry. Chickens being killed at the rate of 1.5 every second. They weren't even dead. They were still fully conscious when they were put into the scalding tanks to remove the feathers. They were basically being boiled alive. The speeds, the line speeds on the slaughterhouses were so fast. Pigs, them just absolutely abominable. And then, of course, pig producers were producing too many of the animals. And so because there was abundance of these animals, they would kill them on the factory farms before they even sent them to slaughter, because the slaughterhouses couldn't cope with them. And what did they do? They turned off the air conditioning and pumped steam into these areas where the pigs were kept. They were basically cooked alive and then discarded. You know, this kind of thing is just not acceptable in a civilized society. Someone once said that, you know, we will one day look back upon this as the greatest crime ever committed by humanity. Our relationship to the non-human world is we're going to pay the price. And how does one go about changing these things? Well, one of the things that I would like to see happen is more of this message being embedded into the entertainment industry. I'm a part of the entertainment industry. I now spend most of my time writing, but you know, I'm still very much involved in film production. And I want to see this brought about, not documentaries, because there's a very limited audience who watches that, but that people in the entertainment industry, mainstream television, mainstream movies, we have to let it trickle down. This message has to come down and be embedded in the way we entertain ourselves. It's not all about war and entertainment and happy entertainment to binge on over a weekend. We've got to have a message somewhere in these movies that we're making that brings us to the consciousness and the awareness of a mass audience. And that's what my focus is right now, to somehow get to that point where Hollywood wakes up. I don't know if any of you watched the Academy Awards a couple of years ago, Joaquin Phoenix, when he got his Oscar for his best performance, you know, when he made his speech, he actually made a speech about calves being removed from cows. He's a dedicated vegan and animal rights supporter. We need more people like that. And all I can say is that it has to become a concerted effort. I will do all in my power to help bring this about. And I respect all of you for what you do. And I feel deeply respectful to be in your company, but there's a lot of work to be done. And we've just got to get on with it because the time is now. We are breaking every precept and law and commandment in the Torah. And this has to end. We've got to change the way we go about our world. And thank you for having me on the show, Richard.
Okay, thank you very much for being on, and thanks for your very powerful words, and hope your wishes will come through, and how it would come through on that. Okay, our next speaker is Lisa Levinson. She's the director of the Defense of Animal Sustainable Activism Campaign. She's a co-founder and co-director of the Interfaith Vegan Coalition. Been quite a bit, co-founder of Public Eye, which is Artists for Animals, which is trying to teach compassion for animals to the arts. She's really been a pioneer leader in connecting veganism to spirituality. So, look forward to hearing from Lisa.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Richard. It's really a treat to be here, especially with these esteemed rabbis, inspiring speakers, and also the spirit of my grandfather, Rabbi Martin Waits. I'm so excited to revive and restart this sacred new year for animals, to share Jewish teachings on compassion for animals, and to shift veganism, to shift into veganism so that we can avert this climate catastrophe that many of you have talked about today. And also wanted to tip my hat to Rabbi Arthur Waskow, who was an inspiration when I lived in Philadelphia to create our own sacred vegan rituals. That's where I started a vegan spirituality many moons ago. So Philadelphia seems to be a catalyst for different events to raise awareness for compassion for animals. When I ran Public Eye Artists for Animals there in Philly, we taught compassion for animals through the arts. We did an interfaith animal blessing with vegan drumming, dancing, and blessings by spiritual leaders, including rabbis. And also we had communal Reiki for the animals who joined us, combined with an arts-based festival and booths from local groups that helped animals. So our vegan spirituality group that blossomed from Public Eye Artists for Animals was really composed of many different individuals who attended synagogues and churches, and they felt that their vegan values weren't included from where they worshiped and practiced. So that's why we joined together with that common theme of veganism, just to explore what did it mean to practice veganism in a spiritual way together. And from there, our Interfaith Vegan Coalition, which the beginnings of that coalition that was founded under the auspices of In Defense of Animals, the film, A Prayer for Compassion, chronicled the start of our coalition, which includes Jewish Veg Shemayim. And also we welcome many other Jewish groups who are part of this call today to join us. We would love to include this holiday in our calendar and promote it heavily in our newsletters, and we can publish your articles about this holiday. So hopefully next year we can take this event that we have right now to the next level, including wonderful programs such as the Council of All Beings, and start to promote these and share them with our worldwide audience. We'd love to do that. And we launched our Interfaith Vegan Coalition at the Parliament of World Religions in 2018. And just this year, we were nominated to join the Parliament's Climate Action Task Force. And we're very excited to be part of this. And we hope that groups who are aligned with us, such as everyone here, can also add their voices to this Climate Action Task Force, which is made up of international leaders in the spiritual world. And we would love to start to get this message out there even more. And one thing I want to share also is we started this sermon / spiritual presentation contest this year, and perhaps someone can offer a sermon on this revived Jewish holiday. We would love to do that and begin to share it far and wide. So we're very thrilled to be part of this discussion today, and we completely, wholeheartedly support this new holiday that's been revived and would like to help push it out to the world so we can get this message of compassion for animals spread far and wide. So thank you very much for this opportunity.
Okay, thank you very much for all the things that you're doing and for all the wonderful plans that you have. Okay, our next speaker, Jonathan Wolf, is the founding president of Jewish Vegetarianism North America, which now has changed the name Jewish Veg. And he did wonderful work in advancing the two-by-spot Seder many years ago. So we look forward to him doing similar things with regard to New Year's animals, just as he did for the New Year for the trees. I owe a lot to Jonathan. I took his course, I think it was around 1979 at Lincoln Square Synagogue on Judaism and Vegetarianism. That sort of sparked me for writing the book, Judaism and Vegetarianism. And he's been a very valuable editor for some of my books. So look forward to hearing from Jonathan. I know he's on, maybe muted.
I'm sorry. Thank you, Richard, for organizing this. I'm unmuted. You got it? Thank you, Richard, for organizing this and many other Zooms and for all of the nudging and promoting and blasting and emailing and listservs and things you've been doing for many, many years that have helped galvanize people to veganism and to environmental activism. Happy Rosh Chodesh, Chodesh Tov to everyone. I think it's important, it's a wonderful, important idea that we revive the Rosh Hashanah Behemot on Rosh Chodesh Elul. I also think it's important to revive Rosh Chodesh in general. Rosh Chodesh appears in the Bible. Some of the prophets inveigh against the Jewish people neglecting Shabbat and Rosh Chodesh. It's up there with the Sabbath and the biblical festivals. But in contemporary Jewry, people celebrate Hanukkah and Tu B'Shvat and Purim and Hoshana Rabbah, and nobody really does much about Rosh Chodesh. Rosh Chodesh is not only about tshuva today and yesterday, Rosh Chodesh Elul, and then the beginning of Rosh Hashanah, which is a super Rosh Chodesh. Every Rosh Chodesh, the prayer that we say includes the focus of it is that God should accept our repentance and help us to change and do tshuva. So Rosh Chodesh is always about return and repentance, especially on Elul and especially on Rosh Hashanah. As most of you know, Rosh Chodesh Elul appears in the first Mishnah in tractate Rosh Hashanah, where it says there are four New Years in the Jewish year, what we call New Year's Rosh Hashanah, the beginning of the month of Nisan, Achodesh Ezelechem Rosh Chodeshim, the beginning of the cycle of holidays and of months. And according to Beit Shammai, Rosh Chodesh Shvat, and according to Hillel, who wins as usual, Tu B'Shvat, and Rosh Chodesh Elul. And both Tu B'Shvat and Rosh Chodesh Elul at the time of the Mishnah were simply legal demarcation lines of fiscal years. They didn't have spiritual, religious, celebratory status. Tu B'Shvat gained that after the diaspora, the dispersion of the Jewish people. It became a day of celebrating the land of Israel and eating the fruits of the land of Israel. In the early pre-modern era, they used to have dried fruits transported over hundreds and hundreds of miles to Eastern Europe that were grown in the land of Israel. And the celebration of Tu B'Shvat took on fruits and trees and blessings, starting, of course, with the Kabbalists in Sfat, the Tu B'Shvat Seder that they compiled, which was written up in the Pre-Etz Hadar in the 1800s, and we continue to use it and model on it today. And then in the 20th century, Tu B'Shvat became a holiday of Zionism and the return of Jews to our ancestral homeland and of environmentalism. So I was involved in the 1970s in trying to research and revive the Tu B'Shvat Seder. This is the text that I compiled in the late 70s based on research from the mid 70s. And Danny Landis just wrote me a couple years ago on Tu B'Shvat that he still uses it 40 years later. So it still has salience. And we've worked, many of us have worked, many of people on this screen and many people we know have worked to revive Tu B'Shvat and make it an occasion for environmental celebration and connection to the land of Israel and thanking God for trees and fruits. When Richard did a Zoom a couple of years ago for Tu B'Shvat, both Rabbi Seidenberg and I referred to the final pages of the Pre-Etz Hadar, in which there's a lengthy kavanah, wishing a good year for our friends and partners, the trees and fruits, and invoking many psalms and paraphrasing blessings to pray that God should preserve and magnify and take care of and protect the trees and the fruits. So this is an article I wrote in the 1980s about Tu B'Shvat as the original Earth Day. So what we did for that, we can do for this. Rosh Hashanah Behemot and Rosh Chodesh Elul are dry legal categories until we make something out of them. So I've been working since at least 2012 to create a Seder, a Haggadah, an order, a celebration, a liturgy, as several speakers have talked about, to enrich and deepen the New Year of Animals as an occasion for us to sing and pray and celebrate and feel connection with the animal world. So let me just mention a few things that I've begun to put together, and we should all, I think, be working on compiling a variety of celebrations and liturgies for this occasion. Someone previously mentioned Perek Shirah, which is a wonderful collection of verses and prayers about animals. And that certainly should be extensively quoted in any liturgy for Rosh Hashanah Behemot, as should Barchi Nafshi, which we recite every Rosh Chodesh, and which recognizes God's role in continuing creation, including that of animals and nature, and that should be recited. And there are other verses and references I think we should include, the places in the Bible where it talks about God creating a covenant with the animals, right after the flood in Genesis with Noah and in the book of Hosea. There are many, many psalms which feature praise and glorification and identification with the trees and nature and with many kinds of animals and with our relationship through them and with them to God that ought to be included. Kavanah, as I mentioned, that appears in the Pre-Etz Hadar, we ought to update that and write one for the wishing for the new year, the coming year of our animal fellow creatures, companions, and friends, that they should be blessed the same way the Kabbalists of Sfat wrote it, and it's in Pre-Etz Hadar for animals and trees. And then there are lots of different websites and books and research and issues that I think ought to be included. The best book I think on Judaism and the Torah of animals is by Rabbi David Sears, also Emmanuel Shochet and Roberta Kolachevsky, and Samuel Dresner's book for the conservative movement about why all of Kashrut is really about animals and vegetarianism. The Rosh Chodesh is part of a cycle of months. We also have a cycle of days of the week that ends in Shabbat, of the month that ends in Rosh Chodesh, of the year that ends in the four new years, of Shemitah, which is obviously tremendously salient and important this year and every 7 years, and also of Birkat HaChamah every 28 years, which several of us have celebrated a couple of times in recent decades. This is the Chazon wonderful booklet about Shemitah printed before. This is the vegan cookbook of the Jewish Vegetarian Society when Charles and Deborah were its presidents in Baltimore. So then there are many issues that ought to be researched. There are lots of books that I own, lots of websites that I've gone to about issues like endangered species and how God wants us, some of the commentators say that's the reason for some of the mitzvahs in the Torah, of like Otova et Bno, that we are commanded to help preserve and protect other species, not destroy them as we are doing. Factory farming and all the cruelty that is imposed on animals. And by the way, animals that are killed in a kosher style, kosher laws, even if one believes, and I think there's some persuasive reason to think that kosher slaughter is more compassionate, though many disagree with that. But even, I know Jeffrey Tai had a debate with the people from the Grow and Behold organization, he told me, in which he said to them, okay, you're advocating compassionate killing of animals and kosher. When you do that, what do you know about the way they were grown and treated and raised before that? And they really couldn't answer, because many, many kosher animals are badly mistreated, like all other animals, in raising them for meat. And by the way, also for eggs and also for milk. I worked doing some of those on kibbutzim in Israel in my 20s, and I saw, I'm sure it's much, much worse in factory farming on a mass scale in America, mistreatment of animals that were being milked, kept awake night and day so they would give more milk, eggs that were giving hens, chickens that were giving eggs, were de-beaked and their claws came to be immovably connected into the wires that they were kept in the tiny cages. So there's a lot of mistreatment of animals, not only for vegetarian reasons, but for vegan reasons. So I think we ought to be compiling a Seder, a Haggadah, a ritual, a celebration that includes also music like Saint-Saëns, like my cousin Rabbi Levi Kelman in Jerusalem did a recording that I sent to Richard at Parshat Noach, all God's critters. We should be doing music and food and decoration and celebration, and issues that involve our relationship with animals, our preservation of animal life, our improving the ways that we take care of and live with animals, including vegetarianism and veganism, including broader environmental issues, including hunger, which Richard has nudged the Jewish veg to make sure they include whenever they talk about the reasons of vegetarianism, including waste of resources, which also a tremendous amount of damage and destruction is done by the way our societies treat and grow animals. So God willing, we will continue to magnify this occasion as we've done Tu B'Shvat over many decades. And it'll become, as apparently it already is, according to David and others, somewhat of a standard recognized event in Jewish world and Jewish calendars and Jewish communities, that we recognize our relationship with animals and their relationship with God. Rav Kook says in Messianic times, animals will be capable of moral choice, that we will have a totally different relationship between animals and God and between animals and human beings. But already we have covenants of the animals with God in the Bible. So we need to upgrade and praise and raise the standard of the way people and the way Jews deal with and treat animals, and recognize that animals are fellow divine creatures, not created identically but tzelem Elokim like human beings, but definitely with a unique and important relationship with God. And hopefully we can study that, celebrate it, sing about it, learn about it, pray about it on Rosh Chodesh Elul in all years to come.
Okay, well, Toda Rabba, and I look forward to your contribution to the Year for Animals, just as you contributed so much to Tu B'Shvat. So before we go forward, a couple of public service announcements, in fact, that at 1:30 Eastern Time, we're gonna have another Zoom event And that's going to be one, you know, we're looking for different rituals and all, and that'll be one where I prepared, and I should say collected, all kinds of wonderful, beautiful teachings about compassion for animals, biblical teachings, and teachings about from the Torah and what various commentators have said. So everybody's, of course, welcome to that. And it's exactly the same link for people to take part. That's just readings and discussions of Jewish teachings on compassion for animals, just one of the potential rituals in the future. One other thing, because the issues are so great, I'm trying to get my book here, Vegan Revolution, Saving a World, Right About Judaism, as many people as possible. So I'm hoping to give away PDFs of the complete text and the cover, many people as possible. So anybody here, please email me at veggierich, that's VEGGIERICH at gmail.com. If you'd like to get that and share it as widely as possible. So I'm hoping to start many respectful dialogues that will help shift our imperiled planet onto a sustainable path. Okay, so really appreciate all the wonderful talks so far. And we have many, well, 6 or 7 more really important people. And one of them is David Kranz. He is the founder and president of 18 Ecological Judaism. And that has some very good subgroups, including Ecology.org, the Green Zionist Alliance, Eco-Jews, Jews of the Earth, and Shomrei Bereishit, Rabbis and Candidates for the Earth. And I really appreciate Ecology as a place where I put many blogs in the past. So look forward to hearing from David.
Thank you very much, Richard. And a real honor and pleasure to be with you all here. Can you see the see the slide? Okay, is it full screen for you?
We see it. Looks great. Very good.
But it's not full screen.
It's not full screen. Okay, 1 second. May not permit. Well, we'll just keep it like this for now because we're short on time.
Just make the frame smaller, David, and it will look almost the same.
Say again.
You can just squish the frame so it's the same width as the slide, and it might help.
There's also a little button at the lower left. There you go.
Yeah. Did that do it? No.
Not yet. But it's
full screen on my computer.
Yeah. We can all read all the words. So that's
okay. All right. We'll just keep going as is. I'm David Kranz. It's a real pleasure and an honor to be with you today, representing 18 Ecological Judaism and the School of Sustainability at Arizona State University. This is Rosh Chodesh Elul, so we've got 1 month to go before the new Shemitah year. So I wanted to talk to you about Shemitah for animals. But first, great gratitude to Richard and Yossi and Aharon for organizing this, and my fellow colleagues and teachers, Arthur and Ellen and David and Michael and everybody listed here. It is such a real honor to be speaking with all of you and to be sharing with all of you. Thank you all so much. So Shemitah is the 7th year in Judaism, the sabbatical year. Right, and it doesn't matter how you spell it in English; it's all the same. It's always spelled the same way in Hebrew. There's a lot of aspects to Shemitah. I'm going to focus on a few of them in a little bit of time we have today. One is that the land rests. Another is that people rest, and then the third is that the non-human animals also rest. So we have land rest, people rest, non-human animals rest, and all of this generates an equality, an ideal of inequality between land, humans, and the non-human animals. Inequality doesn't necessarily exist in the other years, but in the Shemitah year, how can we make that happen? So the land rests because the land is fallowed. It's not worked. The land gets to rest. The land is resting because people are resting, because people would be farming the land, and we're not farming the land during the Shemitah year, so we also get to rest. And the non-human animals also get to rest. So how does this happen? So one way it happens is that fences are removed. So it's a rewilding. So you have the wild animals that would ordinarily not be able to enter, say, different lands that's either farmed or not farmed. It's, we've put fences there to say this is human land, and all other animals are not prohibited. These fences are removed, and there's the animals are allowed to once again roam free. But it's not just the non-domesticated, non-indentured animals that are rewilded, but the fences are also removed, allowing the indentured animals to also roam free. So the fences kept out the so-called wild animals, the animals outside of human control, largely outside of human control. Although as others have mentioned, you know, these are largely, everything now has come under our control to some extent or another. But those animals are freed, but also the animals that are kept inside the enclosed fence can now roam free. They can also, they're also freed. They're also rewilded. And now this part hasn't really, you know, this is something I'm positing to put forward because it hasn't really been discussed, but I think that Shemitah also calls for a vegan diet for humans. A vegan diet for humans. So where am I getting this from? So from the book of Vayikra, the book of Leviticus, it spells for us what we should be eating in the Shemitah year, because one might say, okay, you're not working the land, you're not farming, what are you going to eat? So the Torah answers, you may eat whatever the land produces, naturally. You may eat whatever, and that's not just you who are eating it, but you, indentured people, indentured animals, right? Your cattle, your indentured animals, and the wild animals, the non-indentured animals, everybody gets to eat from the same food. And what is that food? It's specifically whatever the land grows. So you might say, okay, well, it doesn't say only that. You can eat that and you could eat other things, like you could eat cows still. But Vayikra continues on and anticipating that question, says, actually, no. You're only going to eat the whatever grows in the field. This is whatever is growing naturally in the field. That is what you're going to be eating, and you're not going to be eating, you know, the animals. You're not going to be eating this and that and everything else. You're just eating what grows in the field. This is 1 year, and who's eating it? Everybody's eating all the same stuff. So we're all equal. Everyone is released. Shemitah means released. Everyone is released. Everyone is free, and everyone is equal. We're all not working, and we're all eating from the same things, and for the human, that's to be vegan. So this is, like I said, this really hasn't been brought up to the best of my knowledge, but this sort of, it really fits in with the Jewish history of our diet, right? Because according to our tradition, right, when there's creation, first, you know, people are vegan. We start out as vegans. Sometime after leaving Eden, you know, we're vegetarians. And then after the flood, we're permitted to eat meat, right? And this is like, that's the sort of for the permissiveness of violently engaging with our fellow animals. That is the pinnacle. And then soon thereafter, these permissions start being reined in because the Torah continues with limits on meat consumption. All right, fine. You're going to eat meat. You're going to eat the flesh of your other animals. There's going to be limits on it. All kinds of limits. One limit after another, after another, after another. You know, fine, you're going to do it. There's going to be all these kinds of limits. So it starts getting, it's dialed back. So naturally, if we're thinking about Shemitah as the return to Eden, as Rabbi Nina Beth Cardin proposes, this is a return, and others propose this is a return to Eden, then naturally the return to veganism is part of this return to the idyllic Eden. So this fits in with the arc of Jewish dietary history. And since my time is short, I'll end it right there. And like to thank you all so much again for your leadership and inspiration, colleague, and friendship.
Hey, thank you very much. And I'd love to have you write an article on that idea that Shemitah year should be vegan. I think very few people think about it in that way. So that would be a great contribution, David. if you have a chance to write such an article. By the way, I want to make sure everybody knows, and we're very thankful to Jesse Wolfson, who's hosting this event. He's going to host a later event I mentioned where various Jewish quotations about compassion for animals will be read and discussed. And he also hosted last night's event, where very similar to this, but it was Israeli rabbis and activists that spoke, and here it's people from the US. Okay, happy to recognize next David Jeffrey Spitz Cohen, director of Jewish Veg, formerly Jewish Vegetarians of North America. I'm very proud to be president emeritus of that group and also on the board. And under Jeff's leadership, some very good things have happened. One very important thing, soon to be released, is a very strong vegan statement signed by 150 rabbis. So sometimes we think we're being ignored, but there's at least 150 rabbis. And if we had a chance, probably to reach out to many more, we'd probably get more signatures. Also, there were three or four vegan birthright trips to Israel. And under Jeff's leadership, there's been a board formed, the Rabbinic Council, the Advisory Council, and tours of Hillel campuses in the various colleges in the US. Many, many positive things. So, pleasure to introduce Jeff.
Thank you, Richard. And of course, anything Jewish Veg is accomplished is done standing on the shoulders of Richard Schwartz. So thank you, Richard. And thank you to all of the great leaders, rabbis, and activists who are on this Zoom session. It's great to be with all of you. And of course, it's humbling to be included with such an esteemed group. I'm saying this winging, but I'm going to cede some of my time retroactively to Jonathan Wolf. So Jonathan, you can thank me later. No, Jonathan, you know I love you, because Jewish Veg is also standing on your shoulders. And you have the incredible vision to form an organization 46 years ago to do this work. What I'm about to say is rather obvious, but I think it still merits being said. It's no coincidence that Rosh Hashanah Behema falls on Rosh Chodesh Elul. Elul, as we all know, is a month where we're supposed to engage in introspection. Introspection means examining carefully everything we do, including what's on our plates. Because if we can get people to think deeply about what's on their plates and to look at a piece of meat, and I'm putting that in quotes, to see exactly what it is. Flesh of an animal, and we're animals. That's how we can make great progress. So this holiday really sets the tone for the month of Elul. And I know Jewish Veg and all of the great leaders on this call will continue to work to get people to think, what's on your plate? Where did it come from? How did it get there? And how can we do better? Thank you, Richard. And I look forward to hearing the next few speakers on this wonderful teaching.
Well, thank you very much. And wish you continued success as director of Jewish Veg. Okay, our next speaker is Regan. He's the author of a book way back, one of the pioneering books on Jewish and other religion teachings on the environment. That book is called Replenish the Earth, A History of Organized Religion's Treatment of Animals and Nature, including the Bible's message of conservation and kindness toward animals. He's a longtime animal rights and environmental activist. He's been a longtime friend, supporter, and consultant, and really happy. In the back, his wonderful blurb, very kind blurb, is the back cover of my latest book. So look forward to hearing from Lewis. Window is on. Maybe has to unmute. Lewis?
Well, can you hear me now?
Yeah, we hear you.
Oh, thank goodness. Okay. Thank you, Richard. Richard, I'm really honored to be here on this day when the figs on my fig tree are ripening and we get a report from a distinguished scientific group pointing out that our survival is in danger. And thank goodness for you, Richard, and the people on this panel for the great work they do. Maybe, just maybe, we can save ourselves and the animals and the earth. And I think the new year for the animals would be a big step forward for this. You know, you can hear me okay, right?
We hear you. We hear
all right,
you.
Great. Many of our fellow Jews, you know, are very observant, believing literally in the words of the Torah and strictly following Judaism's teachings. But many of these good people are not, many of these very religious people are not aware of the biblical commandments, the Torah's commandments requiring kindness to animals. So the potential for influencing large numbers of people through what you're doing, Richard, and all of you, is enormous. So even if you're not a religious person, everybody here is very religious when on the things that count, but we can use Judaism's teachings to reach people who are very religious, and the New Year for Animals could be an important part of this. And there's no question that Judaism has strict laws and teachings forbidding cruelty to animals. There is an entire code of laws, Sar Balim Halim, the requirement to prevent the suffering of living creatures, mandating that animals be treated with compassion. Jews are not allowed to pass by an animal in distress or even being mistreated, even on Shabbat. As the authoritative Encyclopedia Judaica, the Jewish Encyclopedia, observes, in rabbinic literature, great prominence is given to demonstrating God's mercy to animals and to the importance of not causing them pain. It says moral and legal rules of the treatment of animals are based on the principle that animals are part of God's creation towards which man or humanity bears responsibility. The Bible makes it clear that not only cruelty to animals is forbidden, but also that compassion and mercy to them are demanded of humans by God. And the encyclopedia sums up the rabbinical law by saying, the principle of kindness to animals is as though God's treatment of humans will be according to our treatment of animals. Similarly, the Universal Jewish Encyclopedia observes that the Jewish attitude towards animals has always been governed by the consideration that they too are God's creatures, and the obligation to respect and consider the feeling and needs of other creatures. The writings strongly urge kindness towards animals, declaring that one who harms an animal harms one's own soul. The kind treatment of animals was part of the moral climate of Jewish living, notes Nathan Ossibel in the Book of Jewish Knowledge. The humane regard among Jews for people extended also to encompass animals, but behind it was the all-pervasive feeling of compassion urged by the righteous. As the Midrash says, as the Holy One, blessed be he, has compassion upon man, so has he compassion upon the beasts of the field and the birds of the air. So I think we could accurately say that the Jews have the great distinction of inventing and promoting and spreading the idea of kindness to animals. It's stressed throughout the Bible and is even required in the holiest of our laws, the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue. God forbids us to make our farmed animals work on Shabbat. We must give them to a day of rest. Indeed, the commandment might constitute the first written record of a law requiring kindness to animals. The first codification of concern for animals, a concept that we pioneered some 3,500 years ago. God's first commandment given in the Bible was Genesis 1:22. It was to the birds, the whales, the fish, and other creatures to be fruitful and multiply and to fill the seas and the sky. And the first commandment to humans was to replenish the earth and have dominion over other creatures, dominion being wise stewardship. These commandments concern the welfare and survival of animals and human responsibility towards them. So the Almighty must have considered this a very important matter. Clearly, God was very pleased with the works of his creation. After he made each creature, he saw that each was good and pronounced the entire creation, when it was accomplished and completed, as very good. Later, when God promised Noah and the generations to come never again to destroy the earth with a flood, he included in the covenant, quote, every creature, the fowl, the cattle, and every beast of the earth. Psalm 38 states, man and beast thou savest, O Lord. How precious is thy steadfast love. And Proverbs chapter 12, verse 10 suggests there are two types of people in the world. A righteous man has regard for the life of his beast, but the tender mercies of the wicked are cruel. And I could go on and on there, you know, from beginning to end. And even in the New Testament, there are various commands based on Jewish law to treat animals kindly and to preserve nature and to respect and revere the creation. So, Richard, again, thank you for all you and everyone does. And let's move ahead with the new year for animals, because it's already the spirit behind it, an integral part of Judaism, and we need to make everyone aware of this. Thank you very much for the opportunity to participate with this distinguished group in this transforming program. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you very much, Lou, and for many years of contributing your teachings on compassion for animals, and best wishes for continued success. Okay, and next speaker, and by the way, because of the time limitations, we've told everybody roughly 5 minutes or so. Everybody has so much more to contribute. I'm hoping maybe after the second new year to start some podcasts. I'd love to interview all you people, and there's so many more out there, maybe a half hour, 40 minutes, and get your views on veganism and during the holiday, so many things to discuss. So we appreciate everybody. Really great statements within a relatively short time. Okay, Rabbi Barry Silver, congressional rabbi since 1996 at the door of the door. And there they stress interfaith harmony, rational Judaism, and social action. He's also the founder of Cosmic Judaism, he merges Judaism and science, and he adapts rap music, and I've heard some of his songs and some of his talks related to Shabbat, and been very thought-provoking, very inspirational. So look forward to hearing from Rabbi Barry. Again.
Thank you very much, Richard. It's a pleasure to be here. Last time I gave a talk, someone said they loved my speech. They woke up from it refreshed. So I'll try not to go on too long. I'm really inspired by you, because you worked really hard and are a fierce fierce advocate for an important cause. And in the face of overwhelming odds, you don't give up, you're relentless, and you have that Jewish indomitable spirit. And there's so many people on the Zoom call right now that are all doing great things. So I feel privileged to be able to add my voice. Some might say we're preaching to the choir, but I think that's a good thing, because I think that this choir all needs to sing in harmony with each other. And it's great for us to be together to realize that there are like-minded people out here. I'd like to make my comments about Rosh Hashanah in this way. Rosh Hashanah reminds us of the creation of the earth. It also parallels our own individual creation. A little baby thinks that the whole world revolves around the baby. Even their parents, they don't think are independent entities. The parents were just put there to serve their needs. And the whole world is just there to serve its needs. As it matures, it realizes, oh, these parents are actually independent beings. And oh, there's another world out there. And oh, it wasn't all made for my benefit. Human beings are the same way. Our ancestors were in a baby-like stage of human development where they thought the entire earth was put there to serve people, and all the animals were put here just to serve us. And the world was at the center of the entire cosmos. The entire cosmos revolves around the earth. Sadly, people who take a literal view of the Torah still think that. They still think in this baby-like, immature, primitive fashion that all the animals are there for us, and the whole universe was created for us, and we have the right to do whatever we want to the animals. And the problem is that these people are called religious. That's not religious. That's indoctrinated. It's primitive. It's archaic. It's brainwashed. And it's harmful. And it's devastating. And not only is it devastating to us, we've spread this virus in a variant form to the Christians and the Muslims who are now dominating the world. And as we celebrate creation, let us celebrate creation in a rational way. The crowning achievement of humanity is our rational mind, our ability to reason. And the crowning achievement of that is through science. And Jews have specialized in science. The greatest scientists, many of them are Jewish. And many of the greatest breakthroughs, not just in science, but in philosophy and learning and understanding in transforming the world are Jewish. And right now, our Jewish people, we have as much impact on the world as a white crayon because we're not speaking out. The people on this Zoom, I want to encourage you to speak out. And one reason why we don't is because the liberals, the progressives don't want to be judgmental. I was on last night with a group promoting All People's Day. And one of them next to me was Orthodox. And she said, they're going to have a petting zoo. And I said, you know, maybe we should have vegetarian food, because if you're going to have a petting zoo, it would be a good idea to have vegetarian food. So she said, I don't want you to impose your bias on the rest of us. And I said, it's no bias. I just don't think it's a good idea to be petting a zoo in one booth and then eating them in the next. And I have a bias towards kindness and compassion and love. It's what makes me Jewish. Now, I know to many people, this is very harsh. I know to many people, this is very judgmental. And therefore, it's wrong. And I'm going to say not to be judgmental is wrong. I'm going to say on the holiest day of the Jewish year is the day of judgment. And the day we stop judging certain behavior to be harmful is the day that we no longer have any morality at all. That's what Wiesel said, that neutrality is the opposite of morality. And so I'm going to ask everyone here to do something that maybe goes against the grain of a lot of people. You know, every time there's a forest fire, we learn about it and we see it on TV. Do we hear about the billions and billions of animals that are dying in fear and horror and terror and the incalculable harm that we're doing to our world by what we eat? Do we even think about it? I'm going to ask everyone here to be more judgmental and to judge things based on reason and science, because science is telling us that we're doing great harm. And I believe that we need to integrate science and Judaism. Science denial in government and politics in America is leading to the proliferation of the coronavirus, climate change, election denial. I think it's time that we Jews elevate science and integrate it with religion, and that we become more judgmental. Because I tell you this, the terror and the harm and the violence and the cruelty and the devastation that we unleash upon animals, if you can't judge that to be wrong and speak out clearly about it, then you're ignoring the whole prophetic tradition of Judaism, which is a religion of judging between right and wrong. And that's the only way you can possibly choose life, is to judge some things as antithetical to life. And I thank you so much for the opportunity to share some thoughts with you.
Okay, thank you very much. And strongly agree that we have to speak out, always be respectful, but number one, we have such a strong case. And number two, the evils out there are so great. I often think animal-based diets, it's madness and sheer insanity. When you realize all the hunger out there and we're feeding grain to animals while people are starving, and what we're doing to the environment, what's happening in health, that the fact that doctors don't recommend much healthier vegan diet. So we have a lot to speak out about, and I try to send letters to the editor like once a week out here to do some posts. So I agree very strongly with Barry on that. Okay, we're down to the final couple of speakers. Look forward to them. Becky O'Brien is Director of Food and Climate for Chazon, wonderful group, the Jewish Lab for Sustainability. And she brings to her work her experience in project management, volunteer coordinating, programming, advocacy, fundraising, communications, and nonprofit administrations. So look forward to hearing from Becky.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending what time zone you're in. Thank you so much for having me, and amen, Rabbi Silver. Mm-hmm. So thank you for having me. And so when I was 19, I saw the film Alive. It's a true story about a rugby team whose plane crashed in the Andes. And some people survived the crash, others didn't. And the ones who survived the crash ultimately survived being stranded in the mountains for an extended period of time by resorting to cannibalism. So a few days later, I was at my waitressing job and we were having our staff meal, which was always some sort of chicken pasta combination. And I'd already eaten about half of it. And I was bringing the fork to my mouth and there was a piece of chicken on it. And I suddenly looked and I was like, oh, gross. That's body. That's like me. And that was the first time, I was 19. And that was the first time that had clicked for me. And I've been a vegetarian since then. A couple of years later, when I was in college, I read Walden by Thoreau, and I know it's very cliche, but that turned me into an environmentalist. And then over the years, I learned about how our food is grown, raised, packaged, shipped, and how big of an impact that has on our food system. I learned about factory farms and the industrial system that creates 99% of today's meat and dairy, kosher included, and how these are leading causes of climate change. And so it became clear to me that my food choices and being a vegetarian and being an environmentalist weren't actually two separate things. They were completely overlapping. And that's not even to mention what I began to learn about animal welfare and about the impact of meat on personal health. And over the years, I've been decreasing my consumption of dairy as well. So I've been an environmentalist and a vegetarian for nearly 30 years. But honestly, that whole time I've been struggling, do I matter? Do my choices make a difference? I'm just one person. And while I always kept up the behavior, if you will, I really struggled emotionally and psychologically about whether I was ever really making a difference. Did I have any power at all? And so I read a book a couple of years ago by author Jonathan Safran Foer called We Are the Weather, Saving the Planet Begins at Breakfast. Ostensibly, this book is about industrial animal agriculture and climate change. But for me, the book was about that question that I was struggling with, do I matter? And when I finished that book, it was really clear to me, I totally matter. Each of us all matter. And in my work at Hazon, I had the privilege to be able to create a discussion guide. We Are the Weather, Saving the Planet Begins at Breakfast, discussion guide for Jewish communities, for individuals, organizational groups to come together and read the book and reflect on some Jewish texts and studies with it. And because of my own baggage in this area, created a whole section called Do My Choices Matter? What Can I, Just One Person, Really Do? And so I wanted to just share a couple of quotes from the book, a couple of the teachings that really hit home for me and that I was privileged to be able to put into this guide to share with people. Forer says, is there anything more narcissistic than believing the choices you make affect everyone? Only one thing, believing the choices you make affect no one. Another teaching he has is, unless you buy your food in secret and eat it in a closet, you don't eat alone. Our food choices are social contagions, always influencing others around us. Supermarkets track each item sold. Restaurants adjust their menus to demand. Food services look at what gets thrown away, and we order what she's having. We eat as families, communities, generations, nations, and increasingly as a globe. Individual consumer choices can activate collective action that is generative. We couldn't stop our eating from radiating influence, even if we wanted to. And man, that really hit me. We couldn't stop our eating from radiating influence, even if we wanted to. Not only do I have a lot of power, I have it even whether I want it or not. And so that combined with this teaching from Rabbi Tarfon, he said, it is not your duty to finish the work, but neither are you at liberty to neglect it. And so I'm the director of food and climate at Hazon. And it's these teachings that keep me in balance. It's these that keep me from feeling overwhelmed on one side and from getting dismayed and disempowered on the other. They help me make my food choices with intention and to be able to work to inspire others to do the same. And I will post in the chat a link to the discussion guide if anybody's interested in that. I'll also post a link to Hazon's Rosh Hashanah Labahemot page. If you have an article or resources that you would like to have added onto that page that's not always already on there, shoot me an email. I'll put my email in the chat as well. We'd love to include it so that that is there for people to find. And thank you, Richard, for organizing this. Thank you, everybody, for being here. I'm delighted to be part of this community. Honored. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for a very interesting statement. And down to a final speaker, last but certainly not least, Devorah Browse is a creator from Soul to Soul, she's an urban homesteader. She also presented a talk at the TED. And she's a frontline community organizer, and she is also trained extensively in conflict transformation, facilitation, and nonviolent communication. So look forward to hearing from Devorah.
Thank you. Thank you so much for organizing this. Thank you so much for including me. And I feel really, really honored to be among these rabbis and teachers and community leaders. I wanted to just contextualize where we are right now in the midst of 700 miles of land being burned down from the Dixie Fire, which is decimating towns and entire ecosystems. And like to hearken into this sacred moment of time of a new year for the animals from that place of deep humility where we're also acknowledging land. We're learning from the indigenous land back movement, from the right land rights movements that are surging all around us. And to say that I'm calling in today from the Tongva and Chumash lands of Los Angeles. And, and that speaking about the rights of animals for me comes very much from this place of humility, of learning a lot about the rights of animals and the rights of nature from indigenous peoples. So I just want to echo what Rabbi David Seidenberg wrote in the chat, that it's important to realize we're not alone in the idea of revitalizing a sacred respect for the more than human worlds. I'm really inspired by the conversation around the rights of nature and nature in all forms that has the right to exist and persist and maintain and regenerate the vital life cycles. And so I'd like to like sort of bring the conversation into a slightly different direction by saying that we can't turn a blind eye to the way that conventional ag and industrial systems, the way that people treat animals, and Parshat Re'eh of this very week has us calling to destroy their altars, to break up their memorial stones, to burn down their sacred trees, and to obliterate their gods from that place. We can't just look at what we're doing right. We also have to look at what that means when we are asked to break down, to burn down the sacred trees of other nations. Not to mention that over 800,000 trees have been uprooted and destroyed in Israel for political reasons. And so when I'm speaking about this, like I come from a place of really being deeply shifted by Sefer HaChinuch and the notion that not even one grain of mustard should be lost from the world. And so as we're talking about revitalizing a new year for the animals, I think that there are also vast implications for systemic repair and for climate transformation. If we think about what is happening with soil microbiology, and the decimation of the bacteria and the algae and the fungi and the protozoa and the nematodes and microarthropods and the earthworms from the ways in which we are practicing conventional farming and industrial practices in this country. It's really bad here. We're losing 30 soccer fields of soil every minute, mostly due to intensive farming, according to the International Federation of Organic Ag Movements. And so what I'd like to suggest is that we expand the idea of the new year for the animals to also include the soil food web, and that there are very tangible practices that we could be doing, for example, massive scale composting at every synagogue, at every day school, absolutely at every home. 58% of all of the waste on the household level could be going back in to create soil fertility, to shift from like people needing to go to the nursery to buy inert dirt, which is dead, to creating soil that's alive with the waste that we provide on that we generate as people alive today. And so by creating our own soil, by composting our waste, we're creating fertile living soil ecosystems and replenishing inert dead dirt with life force. And so that's a very tangible practice that could be happening and should be happening all through this coming Shemitah year, like a regular way of adding life force back into the soil. So I'd like to end by saying that right now it seems to me like we're back to Parshat Re'eh. We're very blind. We don't see the way we're treating animals. We don't take enough responsibility for the way we're treating the soil either. And that we could very much be thinking about the things that we don't see that are right beneath our feet by opening our eyes to the blind and to those blind spots. Ruchaya Eloheinu Ruach HaOlam Pokeach Ivrim. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very, very much. And I want to thank all the speakers. I appreciate all the compliments I've received, and I want to express them way back to you. Every speaker has really been inspirational and has provided valuable information. And I hope this is just the beginning, you know, that I hope we'll stay in touch and we'll find a way to share ideas. Maybe there should be, maybe there is, and Aharon can talk about that, a website. where all this information can be put together. So again, I want to thank everybody. If anybody has a chance to attend, there's not that much time before the next event at 1:30, but there'll be many readings and discussions. At that, again, thanks very much to Yossi Wolfson and Chodesh Tov, and all the best to everybody as we sign off. And thanks, and sorry it was so long, but I think it was well worth it because we had so many great talks. So many thanks to everybody for your great contributions. And shalom from Israel.
Thank you, Richard.
Okay. Thanks again to everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard.
Things are Richard.
Thank you, everybody.
Wonderful gathering, Richard. Wonderful talk, and you've done it another wonderful accomplishment.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Richard.
Everybody's contribution made it so wonderful. Thank you. Couldn't do it without everybody being so involved.
And we wouldn't do it without you, so.
Okay, well.
Richard,
we inspire each other.
Richard, could you send the presenters today the emails of all the other presenters so that we would be able to talk to each other, learn from each other? It would be great to have the emails of people so that we could continue this discourse.
Definitely. And also, I hope very relatively soon we'll be recording of this, and I hope everybody will share it very, very widely to all the various groups. And just the beginning, and I hope a year from now that will be far, far further down the road with many great, great ideas for celebrations, etc.
Okay. And hopefully many people celebrating it all over the world.
Oh, amen, amen. Just a few words.
Chodesh Tov.
Okay, so Chodesh Tov, have a wonderful day in Kotu.
Rosh Hashanah ve'yimot tov.
Okay, all the best. I have to sign.
Shalom chatima tova.
Okay, so I'm going to leave.
Bye-bye.